have with us today a woman who became a national celebrity for standing up for LGBT equality. She won the precedent-setting lawsuit for lesbian and gay child support at the appellate level in our nation. Please welcome Lisa Cove and her son Scott.
And not that of my employer, the Department of Defense.
Hi, everybody. That's me, Lisa Cove. When this began, I didn't know if I was going to use my entire career or worse, end up as a statistic in the FBI under hate crimes. Life, it can take you through the roughest paths, and in this case, it really did. I'm a veteran, and my entire career has been with the Department of Defense. I always enjoyed quietly getting things done in the background, type A personality, workaholic. And I did good. And then suddenly, something hit me like a brick wall. I sure didn't see this coming. I had moved around a lot in DOD, worked joint projects, etc., and projects just for my service. Then suddenly, I was transferred to California. And when I arrived, I was told I couldn't check in. My boss was under the theory that don't ask, don't tell didn't stop at the military, that civil servants could be fired if they were lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender. But she just called all of us gay. It didn't matter which of those categories you fell in. She wanted me to take leave when I arrived. I refused, so she put me on admin leave and told me to take a tour of San Diego. That tour lasted almost half a year until she was forced by the folks in the D.C. area to have me report for work. I was her most senior person, and she didn't give me a real job. She put me behind the deliveries and the microfilm. And everything you could imagine, and then some happened. The harassment was unbelievable. Finally, I had no choice. I had to do something. My initial option was to go to the Office of Special Counsel. That's where they handle discrimination based on sexual orientation. But I've had an entire career, and I was fairly senior, and I wanted to give our parent organization in the D.C. area a chance to right this wrong. That was a good call on my part. First, they sent out three senior folks to do a management review. What followed was an inspector general's investigation with a whole bunch of lawyers. Then, both the commanding officer and lead civilian, who I came right below, were given the choice of criminal prosecution or resignation, and they chose resignation. And that was in 2000. That same year, I set a legal precedent at the appellate level for lesbian child support. Equality activists, we aren't born, we're created. And that situation, it made me what I am today, somebody who tells the truth about these things. Years later, I found out that what happened in my case, where the two senior people in charge of an organization were held responsible, was the first and only time that that had happened so far in the federal government. For harassing a member of the lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender community. Let me tell you what this discrimination feels like. Picture a fist going in your gut, and as it's going really hard and powerful, it's turning inside you, but it never leaves. That's what this feels like. It just never leaves. And the only way to stop this type of discrimination, it's not with an executive order. Those things can be ignored and often are. I was just lucky. Most of my friends that have been in all kinds of levels that have lived through this discrimination never received any help inside the federal government. In fact, the opposite happened. They were actually penalized for complaining. So what we need is something better than an executive order that can be ignored or can be revoked. We need a law. We need the Employment Non-Discrimination Act now. Not later, now. And there's no reason why we can't get it passed. There are members of both parties that support it, but it takes you. You've got to get involved. Now, where I get my strength from, it's definitely from my kids. My family means everything to me. When everything first happened in 1998, they were 7 and 5 years old when I arrived. I love them, and they mean everything to me, and it's because of them that I have the strength to fight this injustice. Because I don't want to ever see any of them live through this, or any of your kids or your family members live through this. Anyway, you get to meet them, and you'll see they've all got their own opinions. I didn't raise them to be a carbon copy of myself. I raised them to be themselves and to think for themselves. Let me know what you think, and I'll see you later.
Hello, we are the Cove children. This is our eldest brother, Scott Cove.
Hello.
I'm the eldest of the quadruplets, Sarah Cove. This is the second one, Lena Cove. Third, Willie Cove. And fourth, Francesca Cove.
So what basically happened was when our mom first came here, she was being transferred over from the East Coast, of course, to here, get a job, and on her way here, when she went house searching, she did, in order to let them know why she was house searching and things like that, had to let them know about the custody battle going on with us between my mom and then our other mom.
Her ex.
Her ex. And so when she let, it was her boss, know that, she was unaware, though, that this boss had a
deep prejudice
against people who are lesbian or gay, and so that created some problems.
Amongst those problems was that, how should I phrase this?
Her boss would treat her pretty badly. Her boss told her that she didn't want her to come in to go on leave. And so our mom ended up not doing any real work. So when we first moved here, she was home a lot. Which is like, because we only
really
had one
weird.
Person. Yeah, that was really weird for us. But like, we're five kids, so we didn't notice it too much.
Yeah.
The other negative is there was potential for her to be fired.
Yeah, if, you know, if it weren't for her friends amongst the work people who were very senior to even her, there's the very genuine possibility that she would have been wrongly fired, which would have made it impossible for her to get a job in her field. And if she had lost the job, it wouldn't have just affected her, it would have affected all five of us.
I think when you have someone who's able-bodied and good at working, their sexual orientation, their gender, or their color of skin really shouldn't have anything to do with why you select them or why you keep them working. Because if they can do their job really good, that's what matters. Mm-hmm. When you work in a business perspective, it's all about most efficient people, you know? If you have a choice between one person who's not efficient, another person who is efficient and is really good at that job and can get it done like twice as fast.
That's
and
who you should always
they
choose.
Yeah, exactly. It doesn't matter if they're gay or if they're black or if they're, you know, a female or male. It doesn't matter. It should be because you're the most able and most able to do this job. That's what the whole business is about. And it's not fair. It's not even logical to be hiring someone or firing someone with that as one of your main things in your mind when it comes to it. It should be, can they do the job? Can they do it well? And that's it. Exactly, like, and if the government had fired her, they probably would have picked someone who wasn't going to be as efficient because she is really efficient at her job.
She's an insane
and
worker.
That would make it where that person would need to work longer because they wouldn't be able to do it as well. Or you'd have a lot more mistake, which would all add to cost. And those costs in there for that government, those extra costs are going to come down to, you know, taxpayers. So it wouldn't just affect us, but it would affect, you know, the country as a whole when you have all these extra costs, especially if they're not just my mom, but other people who, just because they have a different sexual orientation or color skin, if they get fired because of just strictly that, then you basically are saying, okay, I'm willing to spend more money and make you all have to put your tax dollars and more to this government just so I can get people that I like how they look or I like certain things about the outside that doesn't affect how they work. And that really is just a waste.
Everything my mom does as part of working for the military is paid for by tax dollars, and so she gives 110% and does as perfect a job as any human reasonably can with her job, and that saves us tax money, you know, having to pay tax money because she's getting it done cheaper and more efficiently. If, you know, we got some other person in there who was either less hardworking or less efficient or less talented than her, that would in effect be costing everybody money.
Yeah, so it's not just us. You know,
yeah.
We're affected, but also
the whole United States in a very small way, admittedly, but still, it's affected.
Well, not just her, because if they're doing it to her, imagine what they would be doing to other people who weren't as senior or who weren't able to get that done.
Exactly.
You know, it's not fair, basically. It's not just about fairness, but it's just not intelligent. It's, you know...
It's sort of like that butterfly effect where if, you know, you accidentally step on a butterfly today, that might affect the world dramatically 20 years from now. So, you know, if you fire all of your hard-working, efficient people just because of one shared aspect, then it's going to make the debt bigger. Well,
it has no effect on their actual
work.
Right,
exactly. You know, it's not like how you can't hire a handyman was out of hand. Her job was to do something really well with her brain, and she has a great brain.
Yeah.
And that's true of many people in the military, too, who've gotten fired, you know, back when Don't Ask Them Tell was around, for example.
Yeah.
A lot of people think when children are raised by a gay or lesbian person, they think that there will be something wrong with the child. So we are... a humongous, we're living proof that is not the case. Like, I remember whenever we had school debates about this kind of thing, I would ask people, do you think there's something wrong with me? Like, do you think that there's something wrong because my mom's a lesbian? And they all didn't know what to say because I was considered a really good student. Like, all my siblings were.
And the proof's in the pudding when it comes to your valedictorianship, huh?
And I actually was valedictorian of my school, which also proves that, you know, it doesn't make a difference whether, you know, you have a straight parent or a gay parent. You can still do well in school. Like, all of us did really well in high school. And we're all continuing our education in college. Right now, my youngest siblings, my sister Frankie, she goes to Mesa right now, and she's going to become a teacher.
She's
going to be transferring soon. And then my brother Willie, he's autistic, so you can imagine how hard college is for him. But he's still trying. He's still putting in that effort.
Mm-hmm.
And my sister Lena, she's doing a business major, and she'll be transferring really soon too. And I go to UCSD, and I hope to become a doctor. And,
oh, you will.
And then I have my brother, who goes to STSU, who he plans to. He's a theater major.
Not a theater major.
But no,
no.
It's almost movies.
Okay.
And
No, it's,
It's almost the same thing.
It's about Spanish,
it's movies.
Anyways, all that matters is, you know,
his
own thing, and he's actually really good at it, hence why his master's is being paid for.
Yeah, but, all that means, though, is that, like, it doesn't make a difference. We're all really different. We have different goals. And, it doesn't make a difference whether your parent is gay or straight. Like, you can still do well in school. It has nothing to do with their sexual orientation. We need